Did you know that the order in which you set values for CSS transform property really matters? Do you know how to easily create drop caps to express your brand's voice? And most importantly, can you prove that you really are a front-end developer? Find out all about this and more in the next few minutes. First up, Jake Archibald explains why order of transform properties matters at least sometimes when you're trying to animate Zoom. Let's say you wanted to animate this image and transform it so the focus lands exactly on the cat. As you can clearly see, this is not really a smooth zoom, but rather a zoom happens and then image is transformed or slides to the right so the cat stays in the focus. This is the code for this exact transition. We're transitioning transform property and we're actually transitioning scale and translate. That's all we're doing here. Somehow it's not working as it should. But if we apply to the initial state transform with the value rotate 0, which should be an equivalent to none, then this will work exactly as you would expect in one smooth motion. Let's see the demo here. So what is the deal with all of that? Why does the problem happen in the first place? And how come applying rotate 0 actually fixes it? Jake will tell you all about it in detail and it's really interesting, so I strongly suggest you read the article. But to give you the gist, the deal is that CSS actually has quite a complex algorithm that determines the order in which transitions happen. And in this particular case, scale animation happens first, or scale transition, and then the translate transition. Behind the scenes, the CSS will determine which value transition should happen from. And this will look something like this. Initially, the value will be set to none, but we have two values here, so it will be set to none and none. And then in the final step, the algorithm determines that transform values should actually be scale 1 and translate 0, 0. This is all reasonable, but the problem happens because the scale acts as a multiplier for the translate values. Therefore, as the scale increases, even though translate values are interpolated linearly, the effect is not linear. At the start of the animation, a 1 pixel shift in the translate value results in about 1 pixel shift on the screen because the scale is about 1. But towards the end of the animation, 1 pixel shift value results in about 3 pixels shift as the scale is about 3. So therefore, position appears to change faster towards the end of animation, which creates the swooping effect. The fix is quite simple and all you need is reverse the order of properties. So instead of scale translate, you need to set translate and then scale. Let's see the demo. This works exactly as expected because now, even though translate values are still multiplied, they're multiplied by a constant 3, which gives us exactly the effect we want. So what is the deal with the rotate 0 fix we mentioned earlier? The deal is that the algorithm behind the scenes determines from which values the transition should happen. And this process looks something like this. This is the first step, and this is the second step, rotate 0, then none. And then the algorithm determines that there's no way to actually transition those values properly unless it converts them to matrix. So now we're actually dealing with transform matrix from this value to this value. That's why the animation works. This is a fascinating and interesting article that will really help you understand how CSS animates transitions, properties, and if you ever end up in a situation where the animation or transition is not happening exactly as you want, now you'll know that you actually need to be mindful about the order in which you set the transition properties. Next up, Andy Clark shows how to create interesting drop caps using first letter and initial letter CSS properties. Drop caps, in case you're not familiar with those, are letters that stand out at the beginning of the text. Right here is the perfect example. Today, you can very easily style those using the first letter pseudo element and initial letter CSS property. This is exactly what you would do to increase the size of the first letter. Andy explains in this article that styling drop caps is not about decoration, it's about drawing readers in and expressing your brand's voice. Let me really quickly show you how easy it is to set this up today. I'll open developer tools and I'll select this paragraph. Let's add a new rule here and we're gonna target first letter pseudo element and let's set initial letter to 2. This means that the initial letter now takes 2 lines of height. And this is exactly what you see is happening here. The first letter of each paragraph is really standing out. Of course, you can adjust CSS to make this look really good. And Andy in this article shares a number of tips that you should follow to make those drop caps really good. But for this example, let me just set up padding here. Let's set padding right to 0.5 rem. It already looks better. Of course, you can make this look much nicer if you follow Andy's advice. Something like this, for example, will really make your drop caps stand out and they will perfectly communicate the values of your brand. This week's sponsor is Requestly by BrowserStack. Requestly is an open source development toolkit that allows you to easily set up redirects, modify headers, manage API collections, environments, and mocks. Instead of just talking about it, I'm actually going to show you how great it is. I'm going to jump into another browser window with my project CSS stickers opened. And let's say I want to tweak something on this website, but I actually want to work with the live data that's available only in the production, not on my local development environment. With Requestly, I can very easily set up a redirect that will allow me to test a local file, a local script, on my actual production website. I already have Requestly extension installed here, so I'll just open it and I will create a new redirect request rule. I want to redirect my main.js file from production website to localhost main.js file. This is going to be URL that I want to redirect, main.js, and I want to redirect it to another URL, and this will be my main.js file on the localhost. I'm going to save the rule, and as you can see, it's already enabled, it's already live, so I'm going to jump into my development environment, which is Visual Studio Code, and I will save this main.js file, and I'm just going to add this console log. Hey there, this is a message from localhost thanks to Requestly. I'm going to go back to my browser and to my CSS stickers website. I'm going to refresh it. And Requestly is already running, as you can clearly see. And I see my console log right here directly from the localhost. So basically in 15 seconds or so, I've created a redirect rule in Requestly that allows me to very easily test changes that I want to make with live production data. So if you need HTTP interceptor, API mocking, or API client, Requestly is the extension that you should try out. Hit the link in the description, give it a go, and you'll see how powerful Requestly really is. Thanks so much to BrowserStack and Requestly for sponsoring. Next up, we have a really fantastic checklist that will tell you if you are a front-end developer or not. This checklist, or rather a quiz, was created by Nick Chan, and I will really quickly go over it because I want to see if I am a developer, a front-end developer, or not. What do you think? How many points do I get here? I think I might get all of them. Let's see. Spend 3 hours trying to figure out why your site had a horizontal scroll bar. Back in the day, before I knew the outline trick, I probably did, so I'm gonna check this. Being asked to double the size of the logo, I get double points because I also asked to make it neon green. I don't think I needed to make it neon green, but I definitely was asked to make it bigger. Being asked to move something 2 pixels to the right, I've been asked to move something 0.5 pixels to the right, so I definitely do check this. Had an API for a meta product just break on you suddenly. All the time. Broke the website in production. Of course. If you don't have proper tests, it's very easy to break websites in production. Coded a circular bug where a feature would break in either Firefox, Chrome, or Safari. Choose wisely. I'm not sure about this one, so I'll just leave it out. Tried to explain a coding problem to someone else and solved it mid-sentence. Happened many times. Conducted a search for an issue and the search result contained your own blog posts. No, I didn't have this yet. I really wish that happened to me. Swore it couldn't possibly be caching, but then it turned out to be caching. Yeah. Refreshed production while working on local and wondered why your changes weren't showing. Yes. Cried over DNS settings, or at least threw a very large internal temper tantrum. I didn't cry, but I was frustrated, so I'm gonna check it. Had really strong opinion about either dark light mode. I don't have strong opinions about that. If you prefer one thing or another, just go with it. Some apps I use in dark mode, some apps in light mode, just depending on the app, depending on my current mood, depending on my current preferences. Bought a domain for a side project. Yes, and I bought a number of domains for side projects I never launched. Let the same domain lapse 1 year after you did nothing with it. Yeah. Got 90% of the way through the side project only to abandon it now that you finished the fun part. I don't normally do that, but I think it did happen at least once or twice. Built a project that is so niche that it is basically only relevant to you. I did, but I didn't launch those projects, so I'm not gonna check this. Built a home-cooked app for your family because you didn't want to pay for the alternative. It ain't pretty, but it works. No, I did not do that. Came up with a startup idea, bonus points for each vowel omitted from the startup name. No, not really. Felt the eternal call to redesign your website. Yes. written something in a new framework just to try it out. Yes, I do this all the time. We've written that same thing in a different framework next year because you didn't like the first framework. I don't think I rewrite those things, I just try new things, so I'm not gonna check this. Use at least one web technology that no one uses anymore. Meteor.js, anyone? I didn't use Meteor.js, but I'm pretty sure I used many of those. I'm not really sure which ones exactly. Listen to a web development podcast for fun. Yes, on the ride to the office, I often do this. Shop Talk Show and Syntax. Those are my favorites. Posted something on social media that attracted at least 10 reply guys. Yeah, anytime you mention Tailwind, you're gonna get that. Try to convince stakeholders to adapt progressive enhancement because you were too lazy to build a thing. No, I tried to convince them because it's the right thing to do, not because I was too lazy to build a thing. Filed a bug at a browser vendor in hopes they would fix the bug for you before the site launched. No, I was never that optimistic. Argued with a designer to change the design so the source order would be the same on desktop and mobile. No, never. Look like a wizard in front of your non-tech friends by deleting a paywall. Yes. And the reaction was, I didn't know you were a hacker. I'm really not. Hacked some broken client-side validation so you could submit a forum. Yes. Fixed a website broken styles with your own style sheet. I sometimes do tweak website styles. Wondered what idiot committed that code, only to realize it was your own code. I don't really think about people and my coworkers that way, so I'm not gonna check this. Evangelize the joy of RSS to a non-tech friend. To tech friends, yes. To non-tech friends, no. Fantasize about quitting your job and moving somewhere to enjoy the quiet life, probably taking up carpentry or farming. No, I love tech and I love creative work. Alright, my score is 20, so now you take the quiz and let me know in the comments what your score is. So all in all, this is a really fun project that you should definitely check out. Next up, we have ForesightJS. This is a library that allows you to predict your users' next moves. When I try to move my mouse around this website, you will see exactly what this means. So as you see, the arrow is pointing exactly in the direction where my mouse is moving, so you can use that to trigger some actions. For example, you can load a resource that will be needed based on the user's interaction. And here is a nice playground that will show you exactly what this means. As I'm scrolling around, the things are prefetched before I even get to them, which is really nice and could give you a really nice performance boost if you're working on apps where this would make sense. So if you want to improve the performance of your website and preload things faster, prefetch things faster, well, maybe you should check out ForesightJS, a really interesting library that you might find useful, if not immediately, somewhere down the line. Last up, we have a really nice demo, an endless collection of buttons. I'm gonna scroll this website and you're gonna see that I cannot get to an end because the buttons are continuously being generated. I wanted to show you this project specifically because it features quite a nice use of nth child selectors to make things seem random. If you dig into the code, you're gonna find the button selector, and this selector targets all those buttons, and then you're gonna see specific selectors end of type 3n and end of type 5n. With this selector, Adir tweaks the box shadow to make buttons look a little bit more random. Also, every 11th button is styled a bit differently. I did something like this in some projects where I wanted to make things seem random while not actually making them truly random. So this, as you can see, like three selectors, 3n, 5n, and 11n are enough to make box shadows a little bit different on some items, thus making the entire scene appear pretty much random. The core of this demo is of course JavaScript, and those buttons are really generated randomly, but styling of those buttons, or particularly shadows on those buttons, they're not all the same, are done with CSS using the end of type selectors, which is a really nice use case and exactly why I wanted to show this demo by Adir to you. Thank you so much for your attention. My name is Zoran Jambor. I will see and hear you in a different front-end developer checklist, or rather, in the next video.